Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:05 p.m. Central Time on the 25th of February, 2018. It is Sunday night going into Monday, and we are here on the Earthquake 3D live stream where we do nightly updates of seismic events. And if you're not aware, every Sunday night I issue new earthquake forecasts for areas that we're watching for movement to strike. And before we get into anything else, we need to talk about the large earthquake that hit today over in the West Pacific in Papua New Guinea. This is a 7.5 earthquake, originally started out at 7.2, 7.4, was taken up to 7.6, then taken down to 7.5. Big earthquake and big shaking across the area. I'd like to take the time to show you what's at the earthquake epicenter. This is worth taking the time to look it up. I'm going to turn on a display capture, and we will get the coordinates from the USGS or EMSC. We'll use the USGS. And I always recommend you do this when a large earthquake strikes. Go look it up, see if there's anything nearby. So as we zoom in on the area, you're going to see we have a Smithsonian place mark 9 miles away, 15 kilometers. Sisa volcano, a Pleistocene ancient volcano, stratovolcano covered in trees, hasn't erupted in eons, and there it is, 9 miles away. Also, right up here to the east-northeast, we have a huge gas processing facility which processes gas, natural gas, but the natural gas is collected over 700 kilometers distance. And just for perspective, 700 kilometers distance brings us all the way over here into western Papua New Guinea and brings us all the way as far east over to here. So that's 700 kilometers. I don't know where they're collecting the gas from. It is being processed at this facility. So there's not, I don't think, deep well drilling going on here. Now, I may stand corrected. There might be. Who knows? Could be right along through here. Maybe it's 700 kilometers of pipeline total that goes along this area. Who knows? If you're from the area, maybe you will know, right? Okay, so we have a big earthquake striking next to an ancient volcano in Papua New Guinea. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Let's just go back just a little bit, 2 months, when Katovar volcano, you see this? See how it's covered in trees and tufted off? This hadn't erupted in human history, and it came to life 2 months ago. And there's Blup Blup, just as reference. You'll remember it forever because of that name, right? So we have Katovar volcano that came to life 2 months ago after never erupted in human history. Now, here we are. We have a new large earthquake next to Sisa. And I'd like to take you back also. Before Katovar erupted, there were those 6 and 7.0 earthquakes that struck right across northern Papua New Guinea. Does that mean that this one's getting ready to come to life? I sure hope not. With the proximity to that natural gas facility, I guarantee you they built that natural gas facility for processing here because it was probably thought to be pretty stable. But look where it is. Let me turn off our borders and labels. It's on their edge of their interior portion of the craton. Don't those plate structures look familiar, guys? Look at that. Looks just like the plate going across Arkansas or across over in Europe, in Eastern Europe. But this time we are on the plate boundary going across in Papua New Guinea. Okay, so that's a very large earthquake striking there, 7.5, causing major shaking across the area, and damage, of course, in the local villages, power's out, and I don't know of any injuries. I don't think there are any, but we won't find out for a few days. You can't always rely on the first day's reports. Now, I'd like to tell everybody, we were looking for a large earthquake to strike here at New Caledonia, and instead it hit here. So is New Caledonia going to get hit? We'll get into the forecast in just a little bit, but we need to talk about the other earthquakes that struck today. But before we get into that, well, we got to talk about the 6.8 that did not hit on the West Coast. And because it did not hit, all the activity downstream did not occur as expected. So we didn't see any activity major up in Yellowstone. We did see swarms, and we'll get into what struck, but the 6.8 did not hit. And that's big egg on my face. However, I will tell you when I see an area that's a halfway point between two large earthquakes. And that's exactly what we base the West Coast on. 7.9 earthquake up here in Alaska a few weeks back. And the 7.5, 7.2 that struck down here in Mexico just a week ago. So we had 2 7.0 earthquakes, and this is the halfway point. Nothing. And I mean zero, nada, zilch, not a 3, not a 2, nothing struck out here. And that's concerning to me. All right, and we'll talk about that in a second, but it did not hit. That's a miss for me. Now, rest of the planet, we did okay this week. I'll say we did a little bit better than flipping a quarter. That's not good. In other words, we're not good this week. But this week, things went quiet. And we saw that happen halfway through the week. Now here we are, and we're back in earnest on the last day of the forecast. So I'm going to look in the areas we were watching for a couple more days, just myself. I'm canceling the warnings at the other areas that did not get hit, but for myself, I am still watching New Caledonia. I am still watching on the West Coast, and we'll work that into the forecast tonight. But this is, again, it's a forecast miss for me on the West Coast. It happens. It happens fairly often. So there it is. Now, over here, we had a new deep earthquake coming in at 589 kilometers deep. We need to consult our chart very quickly. 589, we go over here on the chart here, and we're at about 1.17 magnitudes larger that we have to look for from this 4.6. So that takes us up to 5.7. So we have to watch for a 5.7 to be striking at New Caledonia, not a larger earthquake at this point. The large earthquake struck our secondary location at Papua New Guinea. Up to the west-northwest, just after this large earthquake in Papua New Guinea, we saw activity strike up in Taiwan, very close to Okinawa. Here's Okinawa, here's northeast Taiwan. And that's on top of yesterday's fives that hit down to the south in our warned area in North Philippines. So Taiwan got hit again. It's really been hit 3 times all the way around this week. Take a look at it here. Let's go back the full week. Take a look at that. So all around that unnamed volcano, we saw new activity develop. Up to the north in Japan, same thing. New 5.6. That was, again, earlier today, right? I believe that was earlier today. Well, Japan time, it was, yesterday now. But 5.6 struck off the coast of Fukushima. And that was originally a smaller earthquake, I think, and then they took it up in magnitude. It's pretty big, but not big enough to cause damage, and it's out to sea, which is good. I would like to point out our other warned area. We had warned the area right here by Tokyo, just south of Tokyo, and look, we got a 5.0 earthquake just southeast of Tokyo. And I'll consider that part of the earthquake forecast from this past week. Up to the north, new 4.4 striking in Kamchatka, and volcanic activity is on the rise in the West Pacific, and that's in light of the new deep earthquakes. The deep earthquakes put pressure up on the underside of the plate, and I was just reading just a few hours ago about pressure on the undersides of the plates and just what the estimated thought of what the pressure is inside the plate. Some people weighing in at about, no pun intended on weighing in, but at 200,000 PSI inside of the weight of rock, for instance, going down into the crust by many kilometers. And that could even go higher into the millions, supposedly. But so the pressure, once the rock reaches approximately 200,000 PSI, it becomes not hot, it becomes more like wax. It becomes more viscous. So we're still talking about rock, and there may be heat associated with, I would imagine there probably is. And that causes the rock to lose its substance while still remaining rock. It's amazing. So under those pressures, we're talking about getting to the point where it could melt or starts to melt, and that's at the depth where these deep earthquakes are occurring, pushing up on the underside of the plate. Okay, so now you understand that, pushing up on the underside of the plate through the asthenosphere where the semi-melted rock is, we need to go over and consult the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. So let's do that. Look at what's going on here, guys. Fuego over in Guatemala, regular suspect on the list. Bagana has returned with a 7,000-foot-high volcanic ash advisory. So that's over in Papua New Guinea. That's not normally on the list. Dukono, normally on the list. Mayon appeared on the list a few weeks ago and has gone in earnest another flight level 100, that's 10,000-foot-high warning. Sabancaya, usually on the list. Sanjay, not normally on the list in Ecuador. Sanjay, back on the list. Mayon, again, Fuego, Cinnabon, again, going up to 11,000 feet. That's pretty small, considering we got 55,000-foot-high stratospheric blast a few days back. Keep going down the list. Mayon, Tucono, Reventador in Ecuador. These are usual suspects. And then we have our big earthquake that struck over in Papua New Guinea next to Sisa volcano. But the one I'm concerned about, Sanjay, over in Ecuador, and this means Sabancaya, by the way, Saya, that's just an abbreviation, and Semeru over in Indonesia last night is also the new one on the list. That's a lot of new ones, isn't it, guys? Let's name them again. Semeru right here in Java, Indonesia. Sinabung right here in western Sumatra, Indonesia. Dukono right here in northern Indonesia. And then we get over here in Sisu volcano, where our big plate boundary movement's happening. By the way, look at this diagonal line of quakes. These are all fours and fives. This is about 150, 200 miles across, maybe even more. And it's the plate boundary shifting there, guys. I would venture a good guess. There's going to be, if somebody's intrepid out there, it's a rural area in Papua New Guinea, I would assume, but if you flew over the area, you might find surface deformation that happened across that distance. That's how much has happened here. But we have a big volcano there as well, old. We get over to the east, an Aoba volcano erupted yesterday. It's not on the list today, but it's right here in Vanuatu. Going up to the north, we have Mount Mayon erupting right here. And we go further to the north, and we have an earthquake next to our unnamed volcano off the coast of Taiwan. Further to the north, Sakurajima erupted yesterday. We get up to the north from there, and Ebiko erupted yesterday. So that's a lot of eruptive activity in the West Pacific. We go over to the East Pacific, and we have some volcanic activity, but not as much. So Mexico has gone quiet, no eruptions at Popocatépetl, but Fuego is erupting. Costa Rica has gone quiet. And we get down here into Ecuador, and we have Sanjay and Reventador both erupting. Further down to the south, Sabancaya erupting, and yesterday we had the volcanic water vapor emissions coming from Nevada's Del Chilean. So that's a lot of volcanic activity going on in a day's time, wouldn't you say? With all the deep earthquakes that just popped up, I'm not surprised by that. And then nestled in the middle of all that volcanic activity, we've got our Big Seven popping off. So that's today's activity in the West Pacific. Once we go all the way over here past Asia, getting into the Middle East, we get into a round of fours that is hit again. 4.6, 4.5, 3.6 across South Iran. These are at volcanoes as well. Let me go ahead and show it to you and prove my case. Guys, we're seeing an increase going on across the board, striking at volcanic locations right now. This is pretty interesting to see happen. So we'll zoom in and show this to you. We're on the edge of the plate boundary. Now, first of all, look at the shape in the plate. Now, this is just a spot that I showed, what, a few days back, guys? This is in South Iran. And see all these? These are laccoliths that are magma intrusions in the plate that bulge up in domes. And then they collapse, some of them collapse. And when they collapse, their magmatic contents sometimes escape out. And in this case, up to the north, a glass flow occurred at this one. So when it ruptured, the glass flow, of course, flowed out across the whole desert there, and it's a huge dome. You can make that out. And at the center, we have a new dome rising. But just make out that glass is a type of lava that flows. So they're all over here, and when you get over to the west, they're older, but you can still see them nestled in here. So we still have them in there. They're just much, much older, and they haven't collapsed. A lot of them have not collapsed, like this one here. Did not collapse, or if it did, it eventually drained out whatever magma was intruding and just allowed for a crater to eventually settle and form. Not like this. This is a mountain range. So that's erosion and erosion marks. That's oval-shaped. We're talking about these here that form in the plate. Okay, and they're just nestled in here throughout. The younger ones are over to the east where they've actually ruptured, like for instance here. All right, so now you see it. So we have a series of earthquakes striking along there, along the southern edge of the plate boundary, where we have volcanoes. Going over to the west, though, we get into the central Aegean Sea. And finally, on day 7 of the forecast, we see our earthquake strike right in the central Aegean. I had named the central Aegean to be on watch this previous week. Several other locations got hit within the magnitude, for instance, in Italy, also up at the Austria-Swiss border from last week and this week. And the only people that didn't get hit this week were up here. I was watching up in northwest Germany near my people at the Holland border, and that did not occur. What happened instead? It got blocked right here near Venice. And up in North Italy, a new 4.0 earthquake, basically. So 3.8, 3.6, a bunch of twos. If you add them together, that equals 4.0. That all struck today. Now let's get into the United States. What happened with us? Well, in the U.S., take a look at it. Going across Colorado last night, we talked about the fracking earthquakes. You guys remember this last night? Today, we have new activity striking over to the west. Let me turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed. So we didn't get our big 6.8 this week. Instead, all we got were threes going all the way down the coast. Well, why is that? Where did it go? I think energy is still trapped out here. We haven't seen a single earthquake strike out here to relieve any pressure. Instead, interior to the plate, look at the last 24 hours. Southern Colorado, fracking operations. Up here to the west-northwest, look at our swarm inside of Yellowstone. So this swarm adds up to about a 3.7, maybe 3.8 at the most, over the course of the past several days. So Yellowstone, volcano, swarming. Pumping operation getting hit down in southern Colorado where humans have drilled. I've shown it so many times in the past, I don't think I need to show it tonight. Same with over in Oklahoma. Both are fracking oil extraction operations as well as injection well operations, and they're just huge. There's thousands of drill points that go down into the crust. I could show it to you, but we've got other things to get into here. Take a look across California. We've got two sets of diagonal lines starting up in northwest California and going down the coast and going down the interior border with Nevada. Starting up to the west-northwest, we get up here. This is Geysers, California, also known as Clear Lake Volcano or Cobb. And Geysers, California is along a fault zone, but it's a geothermal pumping operation. It's a volcano called Clear Lake Volcano that humans have drilled into, and they're extracting the steam to turn steam turbines. And there's earthquakes that strike here. It's like a pressure sign that something's coming in. Let's just show it to you. So we'll zoom in, and we have pipelines that go to these steam turbines, and the steam turbines are providing electricity, I would suppose, for the nearby residents around Northern California. And they're all over there, and there's Clear Lake Volcano. So there's our swarm to the north. We have a few onesie-twosies striking on adjacent faults to this up to the north from here. Over to the east, we get into the Lassen Volcanic Center. So we showed that the other day, also going north of Lake Tahoe back to Steamboat Springs. They have it at Incline Village, 10 kilometers from Incline Village. Well, let's just go look this one up. It's worth showing because it doesn't normally get hit with a swarm, and the swarm there is increasing. Okay, so we're right on a mountain range, correct? And over to the east and over to the west, we should look, but over to the east is Steamboat Springs. And feel free to pause it and read it if you need to. We're going to zoom in on it where they have the geothermal pumping ops, just like the turbines that I just showed you over at Geysers, only bigger. And the pipelines just stretch out all across this area. When the swarm first started here, professionals said they were vexed by this, and they couldn't figure out where or why the earthquakes were striking at this location. We made a video showing everybody the pumping operations there, and within a day on social media, they're responding saying, we didn't realize there was a geothermal pumping operation at this location. We don't know if the earthquake swarm is related to this, so we're just going to keep an eye on it, and it'll probably go away. Well, it didn't go away. Now what's happening here is every time a new round of pressure is introduced off the west coast to the northwest up here, it's starting to light up. Now see this diagonal line? This diagonal line goes down across Mammoth Mountain here, where all of these earthquakes are on the California side of the border. And over on the Nevada side of the border, we get over to Black Dyke, and we get over to the North Long Valley Caldera. So we've got a big location in here that's all volcanic. Mammoth Mountain, I don't even need to tell you about it. If you're into volcanoes, you can go look it up. Mammoth Mountain's also a ski resort. People skiing on there. You know, I think of Dante's Peak, the famous movie with Professor Harry Dalton. He's warning for an eruption, and people are trying to sell ski resorts or something. That's not going to erupt now. I'm just saying it just reminds me of that. So let's zoom in down here. Take a look at this earthquake. Where are we? We're at Beatty, Nevada. And this might ring a bell for a few of my viewers if you're familiar with the nearby area. First of all, let's turn on our borders and labels just so you can see where the California-Nevada border is. And we'll zoom back in. We're right next to the Yubi-Hibi craters. You see this? But up here to the east-northeast, we have a giant nuclear test site that goes on for many miles. Now, they've opened it up to the public. Do you guys know this? That they've opened a large area of this up to the public for people to come in and do hiking and those sorts of things. So it's pretty troubling. But the nuclear test sites start right here. They go over to the west by many miles. And I can turn on the Google Earth community, which has taken a good amount of time marking most of these nuke test sites. You see all these little letter I's? Maybe I should zoom in a little bit. There we go. We could just click on any one of these. This one, June 28, 1973, 20 kilotons. And all around here, over to the west, is where the French and the English got to do their sites. And then over here, going towards the border, are our first above-ground nuclear test sites. And that stretched all the way around here. Okay, and that's where our earthquakes are striking now. So are they related to the volcanoes at the location, or are they related to the nuclear test site? I'm going to have to say they're probably related to the nuclear test site, the fractures that have been created in the crust there. And it's only microquakes that strike here, which kind of lends credence to the fact that there may be some kind of underground collapsing or maybe further fracturing that occurs from those sites. So that diagonal line, if you go look up, I mean, I'm not going to waste your time going to look up every single one of these. You'll have to take my word for it that these are at volcanoes out to the east. I mean, or maybe you're on YouTube. You probably don't trust the word of anybody. I don't either. Let's go look it up. Screw it. We've got all the time in the world. I'll do the forecast next, but I want to get into this and really show it to you. Okay, here we are. Now, Black Dyke is right here. So there's, I mean, it's right next to it. And the other older formation is there over to the east, and the younger is here. And it's part of a greater caldera that's North Long Valley Caldera on next to Mono Lake. Really, you have duals, one on either side. And maybe I need to turn off all my place marks so you can see this a little bit better. There we go. So see the circular formation over on the right-hand or eastern side? And here's our circular formation. This is Mono Lake, which blew in the past. That's a super volcano about half the size of Yellowstone. That all being said, we get down to Southern California. We have another diagonal line of quakes. This time, I mean, look at it. We are all across the LA Basin now. We're going down to Salton Sea. It's spread out. It's gone over maybe 200 miles at this point and across maybe 100 miles laterally from east to west. We're talking about an expansion of pressure across Southern California. Really, what's going on here is both sides are pushing down to the south and focusing in on the fault in Southern California. San Andreas lit up. All adjacent faults going across the basin lit up. We don't have time to look up each fault. You'll just have to go either look them up yourselves if you want to know fault names. Also, in downtown LA, right next to Inglewood, we go just to the east-northeast of Baldwin Hills. Pumping operations also started to move. So your fault zones, your pumping operations, your dormant volcanoes, and your nuke test sites are all in motion right now. And this is all just today. There's only a few sets of quakes I did not mention, and that's the diagonal line going from San Francisco all the way down here to the creeping section of the San Andreas. That's all lit up with ones and twos. So the magnitudes also tell us what's getting ready to happen here. What's getting ready to happen? Most likely, again, now over the past several days, we did not see our 6.8 earthquake off the coast. There's something building up here to the west-northwest, as if we needed any more signs that something was building. Yellowstone is swarming, and Washington and Oregon are completely quiet. No earthquakes reported out of either state at all. One single quarry blast being reported north of the border, again, back up at that giant quarry. So nothing in Washington and Oregon. we need to go consult the real-time tremor map in light of the volcanoes erupting, in light of the deep earthquakes happening, in light of the 6.8 not happening. Let's see what's happening with the slow slip. First, let's look at 24. There's 24 hours. Here's 48. So 24 hours shows us a stack of tremors down in Northern California, centered around the area west of Shasta at Yreka. Well, okay, there we go. So the slow slip is happening in Northern California, and it's happening in Southern California. Southern California, you can see it laid out before your eyes, going along the coast, splitting and going up on both sides of California, and recongregating back up here at Shasta, which is picked up here with vibrations as the plate is moving. I just played a documentary earlier today on the slow slip over in Japan and up here in Vancouver Island from 2012 and 2011, the Japan Megaquake slow slip and the 2012 Vancouver Island slow slip and large 7.7 earthquake. Now, those slow slips, when they finished or got close to the end, those slow slips over in Japan and up in Vancouver both produced large earthquakes, 7.7 in one instance up here in Vancouver and 9.0 over in Japan back in 2011. So what's going to be the release on this? Well, we have to go over time. How long has it moved? How far has it moved? And how much area has moved? So when we're talking about an area, we're talking about from Vancouver Island all the way down to Southern California as the area that's been moving with these tremors and slow slipping. So that's huge. That's 1,000 to 1,300 miles. And we're talking about a duration going on for over a year. In Japan's case, it was about a year and a half to 2 years at the most. And in Vancouver's islands, instance, I want to say it was about 3 to 4 weeks, maybe 5 weeks of movement, and then it resulted in a earthquake. So in the West Coast case, it's been going on for a year and or more, but approximately a year it's been moving across this distance. Now, the professionals have said when a slow slip stops or starts to finish, that's when the potential of a large earthquake increases on a nearby fault to the spot that's slipping. Well, it's not just this little spot where these red dots are. It's the whole coast has gone into motion over the last several months. So if the whole coast has gone into motion, what's the nearest fault to this location? Well, the fault isn't going to be sufficient. We have to look to something greater. We have to look to the plate boundary. And the plate boundary is the Juan de Fuca to the north and the San Andreas to the south. That's what it is. And it goes right through here on the creeping section of the San Andreas through San Francisco. So far, nothing off the coast. And that is extremely troubling when you're normally earthquake prone and you don't get any earthquakes of any size for how many weeks at this point? Start to raise your eyebrows like I am and wonder what the heck's going on out here. Are they reporting to us earthquakes or are they not reporting to us earthquakes? Because other activity points back up to here, up into Alaska, where we did get our 5. Now let me go ahead and turn back on our 2.5 and greater earthquake feed, and we can just go ahead and dive right into the forecast after this. Up in Alaska, we got our 5 a few days back. Let me show that to you. There it is. So that 5 pushed all the way across over to Yukon, down across Canada, up into the United States Northwest, and then across the plate, diffusing out over towards the East Coast, terminating here at the New Madrid seismic zone. Now, what about over to the east? We were looking for New Jersey to get hit. We were looking for Yellowstone to get hit by a 5. We were looking for California to get hit by a 5 and a 6.8 off the West Coast. None of that happened. The reason it didn't happen, the 6.8 didn't push it. So the pressure did not release off the West Coast. Therefore, Yellowstone didn't move. Therefore, the other locations didn't move with the expected magnitudes as high as expected. Now, the 3s that did strike all can be traced back right up the edge of the Craton. And we get to the U.S. border and we could turn on the Canadian feed. It's irrelevant at this point. You can connect through along the edge of the Craton. Okay, so that's what happened this week. Let's get into the forecast. We'll start over in the West Pacific. This is the way we do it. First, we look at our activity that struck over 48 hours. Then we get, hold on. I've got to do the update for New Zealand. Sorry, guys, New Zealand. Sorry, you were last on my list for this week. New Zealand got hit at the plate boundary at Wellington, and Wellington was struck as a result of the pressure striking down to the south, and the other twos and threes that struck, just take a look across, of course, the North Island, buckling up with earthquakes on the plate boundary. We talked about this last night, the deeper earthquakes on the western side, pointing over towards the eastern side is a new focus, and right here at the plate boundary at Wellington, a new 4.3 mid-range four struck on the last day of the watch. Okay, so again, sorry, that was just the last on my list. Now, let's get into the forecast. So the way we do this, we look at 48 hours worth of earthquakes, and then we identify our silent zones. Our silent zones are areas where we should have earthquake activity over the course of a few days' time, and we haven't seen any. Well, this is a little troubling, because our silent zone for the last 2 weeks has been here, near New Caledonia, and there haven't been any earthquakes of any significant size reported out of this area in a long time. And it's been long enough, but we just had our 7 over to the west. So let's identify our halfway silent zone as north of New Caledonia, back up here, going back up into the Solomon Sea. So we go out of the eastern Solomon Sea, and that's our new warned location, our new halfway point between our deep earthquakes and our 7.0 in swarm. Now look which way the arrows point from the 7. The pressure off this is going to be going to the west and up towards Japan. So everybody downstream from the 7 should be on watch. Here, right here at Solomon Sea, we're only going to calculate this based upon the deep earthquake over to the east. So if we have a deep 4.6 that struck today and a 4.8 that struck yesterday, we're going to combine those together as a 4.96, or basically a 5.0. So we're going to consider it a deep 5.0 at 600 kilometers deep. And let's go consult our chart. Okay, 600 kilometers deep, 5.0, and we add on 1.2 magnitudes. All right, so we add on 1.2 magnitude to this 4.8, 5.0, we get to a 6.2. So we'll watch here at the Eastern Solomon Islands at the triangular bend for a new 6.2 to strike in the next 7 days. Over to the west, let's turn down these rings on this 7.0. We have a new compression point that should be getting hit fairly soon here over to the west from the big earthquake. This puts Western Papua New Guinea under tremendous stress at this point. I wouldn't be surprised at a sudden increase in volcanic activity over to the west from this earthquake. First of all, now I don't forecast eruptions, I'm just telling you, the volcanoes downstream from this, Agung over at Semeru, and then further over to the west at Sinabung. Guys, you just keep watch. I mean, we'll probably hear about it this week, and I'll be talking about it sometime throughout the week. Earthquake-wise, though, this 7 is going to divide 3 ways. It's going to go up both sides of these arrows, and it's going to go over to the east. So I want to take this 7, knock it down by a magnitude in each direction. So it's going to lose some steam. It's shallow. This earthquake here, I want you to consider this earthquake shaking only at that area where the earthquake struck. And, you know, right around it, of course, for a few hundred miles. But the seismic force that I'm talking about here flows like a fluid. So the force, the pressure that I'm talking about here, flows like a fluid across the plate boundaries. It's going to divide like a river. When a river meets a three-pronged delta, the river's going to divide in all three directions, and the force is going to try to flow equally across all three, but it's going to follow the path of least resistance. And in this case, the path of least resistance is going to lead the force up towards Japan and over to the west into Indonesia and over towards Europe. So in the next several days, it's going to take a step down as brute force, this force that I'm talking about here, is pushing its way through the plate boundaries. It's going to drop off earthquakes along the way. How big? Well, up to the north, we're going to get the same size. We're going to get approximately 1 magnitude less to the north and to the west. So where is it going to strike? Let's find our halfway points up to the north. Halfway point brings us in right here next to the island of Guam. So we're going to warn the tiny island of Guam for a 6.0 6.0 earthquake. Now, I could put it at 6.5. We should put it at a 6 because it has to come up and around the bend over to the east. All right, so it's not just going to go straight up to the north. I'm going to knock it down by a magnitude and a half, technically, and bring it down to a 6 over at Guam. Over to the west, I don't think this is any shock to anybody. We're going to watch for an equal-sized earthquake. We'll watch for a 5.8 to 5.9, maybe 6, but more like an upper 5, most likely. I hope I got this right. Striking in north-central Philippines here next to Mount Mayon. We were looking for that this past week. We got it all around it. We got multiple new eruptions at Mayon, and then we got our activity up to the north. But no central Philippines. So we're going to renew that for this week because it's coming. We just got a 7 down to the south. Up to the north, Taiwan again this week. You're due. And you're going to get hit again, most likely right back to where we were before. We're going to be going up to 6.0, just like the earthquake down to the south. 5.8, 5.9, 6.0. Going to be striking right in here in Taiwan. Central Taiwan. And there's an unnamed volcano off the coast. If you want to be specific about where it's going to strike, let me quickly show it to you. Here we go. Here's Taiwan. Let's bring this due north. And zoom in on the area. Here's Hualien. And off the coast of Hualien, we have our unnamed volcano. I'll go ahead and turn on the Smithsonian on that so you guys can see it. Takes a minute for all my stuff to populate here, guys. There it is. There it is. So observed in 1853 by U.S. Navy boats in the location. And it's going to get hit again. All right. Now, as we go to the north, you can see our silent zone here is pretty obvious. Right in the middle of this zone, we have Sakurajima Volcano and Kyushu Province. Now, we have to add up all of this down to the south. So take this 5.0 plus 5.0. That equals 5.1. Add in the 5.2, we get to 5.32. You add in the 4.8, you might get to 5.4. But we're also due for a 6 to be striking here or something very close to it, which means most likely we're looking at something near 6 striking in South Japan. When I say near 6, I'm going to put it right at 5.9 to 6.0, striking in Kyushu. It looks like this is going to be ricocheting. The force is going to be ricocheting up towards Japan. And so the middle point, the fulcrum point in the last 48 hours, fairly obvious, South Japan. We also have another halfway point here on the Izu Ridge, halfway point between this 4.6 and this 5.6 and 5.0. Add the 5.6 and 5.0 together. That equals 5.7, and you got this 4.6 at 221 kilometers deep. That could increase by a 0.2 magnitude, which means we have to watch for something like a 5.8 to 5.9. Let's put it at a 5.8, a little less than a 6, striking on the Izu Ridge. You see where we're going with this? So it's starting at the 7, it's going down to 6, then it's going down to 5s as we go up to the north. We have a new halfway point up here in North Japan, north of Hokkaido. Now, previously, over the last several days, Hokkaido got hit by a 4.2 at 75 kilometers deep. That was an earthquake forecast hit for us. We were looking for up to 5, and a 4.2 hit. All the other locations in Japan got hit parallel to Tokyo and over to the east off the coast of Fukushima. Our new halfway point, take a look at it. Do you see it? Between this 4.4 and this 5.6. Where does it go? Right up here, north of Hokkaido, right on one of the northern, I guess this is the southern Kuril Islands or North Hokkaido. I don't know if these little islands here actually belong to the Kuril Islands or Japan, but anyways, halfway point right there between the 5.6 and 4.4. The 4.4 isn't a deep earthquake, so we're only going to be looking for a 5.7 to be striking right here. Okay, as we go over to the west, though, we've got a pretty significant situation going on. We've got Semeru Volcano suddenly coming to life over here in Java, Indonesia. And it's an active volcano, but it's not one that's normally on the list. So Semeru there and Mount Agung just erupted this past week as well. So that's two volcanoes there 55,000-foot-high stratospheric blast from Mount Sinabung here just this past week. So three big eruptions going on across western Indonesia. No new earthquakes. Last several days. The last one was the earthquake forecast hit for us when the 5.0 strike struck right next to Mount Sinabung. But here we are now, 48 hours in, that's the only earthquake by which to judge on. So let's measure between the 5.0 next to Mount Sinabung and Mount Semeru, which is right here in eastern Java, Indonesia. So halfway point between those two brings us into South Sumatra, Indonesia, right next to Krakatoa volcano. You know, Krakatoa, the famous blast heard around the world. Now, we're not saying it's going to erupt. I'm just saying it's going to get hit by an earthquake. And the size on this, like I said, going to be equal in size to what goes up to the north. It's going to be split three ways. So we're looking for, we'll look for a 6.1, 6.0, somewhere in the six, low six range to be striking in Indonesia as a result of Semeru, as a result of Agung. Oh, I'm sorry, somewhere right here. I'm sorry. South central Indonesia, or central western Indonesia, I guess. And right here, okay, so right next to Krakatoa, and the magnitude on this, like I said, going to be split three ways, going to be in that six-ish range, low end six, striking in Indonesia. Too many volcanic eruptions going on, not to get some activity. Over to the west, well, Myanmar got hit earlier this week, but you didn't see that earthquake reported by the USGS, did you? Nope. All we got was the 4.7, which is still on the feed here, striking over to the east. You remember, I showed them to you earlier this week. The Europeans reported them, the USGS leaving out Asia. Sometimes they do that, you know, system outage kind of stuff. Well, let's talk about it. Where are we going to look? We have to find our halfway point between this 5.0 earthquake and this 4.5 all the way up at north, I guess, is that Tajikistan? So we look between the 4.4, or is that Kazakhstan? Between the 4.5 and the 5.0 halfway point. We don't just draw a straight line. We have to go around this cluster of bends. So we'll go down, around, up, and over, down, around, and back. And our halfway point between the two comes in here in North India at the China border with India. Now, magnitude on this, with the blast that happened, the 5.0, and this 4.5, let's put it at a 5.1 to be striking right here. Okay? So this is a big deal for the people in the area. I know it because some of my viewers live nearby this area, believe it or not. And they have mountaintop villages of houses that are built on mountaintops made out of cobblestone and cinder block. So have an earthquake plan there. And I hope I got this right. If I'm off by a magnitude, it should take a step down coming out of Asia. So this 7 should go down to a 6, should go down to some 5s, and then spread out over towards Europe. Now, speaking of Europe, look what happened here. So Iran got hit. You've got this big silent zone in between here, where we're looking for an earthquake, and here. Well, there should be new activity striking on our letter D. This should, of course, stand for deep earthquake, but this should get hit by a new deep earthquake going up into the mid-range 4 level. Why am I going to look for a new deep earthquake in a mid-range 4? Well, all the others got hit by mid-range 4. Sea of Okhotsk, Sea of Solomon Sea, over at Fiji, all of those started to show movement. Over to the west from there, though. Oh, here, hold on one second, guys. Get out of here, kitty. Get out. Okay, sorry. Sorry, guys. I had a cat doing some weird stuff back there. Okay, we get over to the west. Yeah, I've got four cats. Two of them are back by me. Over here to the west, we have new 4.0 activity. We're going to have to turn down the rings to get our halfway silent points. So our silent zone in here only goes between Iraq and South Iran. So we have a 4.6, 4.5. Add that together, that equals 4.75. And over to the west, we have a 4, so that equals about a 4.8. Let's take it up just a notch to a 5.0, striking near Tehran. This should be very close to Tehran itself, towards the downtown metropolitan area, right at the tip of our arrow. So at the halfway point between all this mess, that's where we're going to watch. And I hope I got that right on the magnitude. I want you to have a 1 magnitude larger plan. just in case I'm wrong. Over to the west, we have 48 hours worth of activity here on the screen now. I think I don't even need to tell you. Italy is going to get hit again. Now, there's already been a new 4.0 earthquake and swarm up in North Italy. And Central Italy got hit by mid-range 3 activity throughout the week. But with this amount of activity, I mean, come on here. Take a look at it again. Look at all these 4s that have popped off down to your south, guys, over the last few days. I don't need to tell you. You're stored up, and this is like the dam that's getting ready to break again. So we've got a whole bunch of 4s stacked up across Greece, Macedonia, Bulgaria, Aegean Sea, and Crete. That's all here. Here, let me turn down the rings so you can really get a good idea here. So imagine this as seismic pressure stored up behind a wall. And the wall, believe it or not, is terminating right at Greece, just south of the Ionia Range. If we add the 4.1 plus 4.3, that equals 4.4. If we add in the 4.5, we get to 4.65, and we can round that up to a 4.7. And then we get a 4.2, we get to 4.8, and we add in the 4.4, and we get to a 4.9's worth of energy. We can add in the 2s and 3s, and that'll take us right to a 5. So we have a 5.0's worth of energy added up total across a region over the course of a few days, and downstream, we only have small swarms. So the central point here in Italy, where we have no earthquakes right now, is going to be put under pressure. And the central silent zone of all the places in Italy is Norcia, yet once again. So here we go again, guys. We have a 5.0's worth of pressure pushing in. It's probably going to lose a half magnitude's worth of energy coming around the bend, which it'll put it above 4.0 back in Italy. Let's put it at 4.5. this time. So I'm taking it up a half magnitude from where I had it last week. Now, luckily, this past week, it came in at about mid-range 3. So let's hope I got it right this time, too, because if it's one magnitude larger, then we're talking big-time problems. Over in Central America and in South America, let's get into this, and New Zealand. For Central America, South America, this all stems back to are deep earthquakes over here in the West Pacific. The deep earthquakes lead to shallower, larger earthquakes. Now, New Zealand ties into this, so we have to incorporate New Zealand, Central America, and South America, since it's all hinging upon these deep events that strike below the plate here. These deep events push across the fractured plate boundaries that you see here. They go east and west, like latitude on a map. And going over to the east, see where our arrows are? See where this arrow points? Points to a cluster of earthquakes. And see where this arrow points? Right at the tip of it, we've got a new earthquake that just struck a few hours back. So it all hinges on this, and New Zealand, you hinge on this. Now, if you're a longtime viewer, I don't need to tell you, when deep earthquakes strike to your north, that's when you start getting 4.0 and greater activity on your plate boundary. And we went all week without it, and then you got new deep earthquakes, and then all of a sudden, boom, central plate boundary went into motion. You see the arrow, how it goes across south of Wellington, north of Kaikoura. Well, it's no wonder you've been hit by new earthquakes on all sides. So it's going to happen again. That's pretty much what I'm getting ready to tell you, but it's going to go up by a half magnitude. So you're going to go up from 4.3 up to about a 4.7, maybe even 4.8, somewhere in that range. Right below 5.0. How do we know that? You've had two new deep earthquakes to your north, a new 7 to your north, a new 4.8 to your north, a new 4.3 to your north, and I say to your north, to the north of the plate boundary. So all that's happened. Nothing's compensated to the south. I'm going to look just south of the red line for a new earthquake to strike. So where's south of the red line? We go Kaikoura to Christchurch. So we're shifting the area slightly to the south this time. Kaikoura to Christchurch. Now, I hope I got that right. And the magnitude on that, I hope I got that one right too. So if I'm one magnitude off, we're getting up to the level where the one that caused all your damage, several years ago at this point. Okay, so that's playing into Central America and South America as well. Look where arrow points, traces back to the deep earthquakes. And like I told you, these deep earthquakes equal about a 5. So we're going to be seeing above 5.0 activity striking in Colombia this week. And you got off pretty easy this past week with fours. It's going to go up a full magnitude from where we are now. What do we got? We got a 4 and a 4.4. So if we take it up a full magnitude, that's 5.4. Let's put it for a 5.4 right here at the Ecuador-Colombia border. As if we needed any more warning signs, Sanjay Volcano and Reventador both are erupting right here. So the arrow points to it, right? The big arrow points right to the country that has the two new volcanoes, or at least one new volcano, and the other one erupting, both going right here. So right next to it, that's where we're going to look for a mid-range 5. Same goes for down south. We're going to look for a mid-range 5. Where? Right into Chile, into Argentina, right at the Chile-Argentina border. So I'll put it on land. I hope I got that one right. It's going to strike over in the mountains, most likely. Look where the cluster is. It's right in the middle of the cluster. As if we needed anything more, center point's going to move. Bolivia over here. Right here beyond the red arrow, we're looking at it, north of the letter D. Bolivia will also show the same sized earthquakes that strike to the north and south. So if we get a mid-range 5 to the north and a mid-range 5 to the south, should be a mid-range 5 in the middle as well. Equal force exerted across the whole plate. When you get a push over here, it pushes over to South America, coming across all the fracture zones, inundating pressure across all of South America, and then South America tries to displace, but it has nowhere to go. Look what's over to the east. More plate. So it has nowhere to go. The force is forced around South America. And I've shown this many times, but I'll show it to you in case you're a new viewer here and you don't know what I'm talking about. Take a look at Google Earth, and I'm going to turn off all my placemarks. And you know what? We need to turn off our borders and labels too, because they kind of get in the way. And I want you to look at South America from the side. And I want you to see how the plate flows around South America. It looks like it's dripping around South America like a wax of some kind, or some kind of fluid flowing around South America. Well, it's not just there. It's all the plates are that way. As the pressure is trying to flow around the plates, it bends and contorts the plates into these strange shapes like that. And in the older portions of the plate, you can see where that happened in the past, a long time ago, and has bunched up and moved on and gotten new continental shelves and formed over time. But these plates are pushed by this seismic force that distorts the rocks at a surface level and causes bends in the plate that are noticeable. And this is, here's Iran, another good example of the plate bending around the interior portion of the craton. So it happens all over the planet. And here in South America, it gets hit like a wall. That force comes across, and it tries to go around the plate. So that's what's going to happen. That's why equal-sized earthquakes strike across South America. Ultimately, you see where our X's are out here? Same-sized earthquakes going to strike down here at the South Sandwich Islands again, going out to our letter X. And up here at the north of Ascension Islands, X marks the spot. We might even get a new earthquake striking out here on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. That may be iffy. I don't know if that one's going to happen, but up to the north certainly will. So our X's are going to get creamed this week as the course of this pressure comes across the plate. Starts over here, flows across the planet, ends up on our X marks the spot. Same for starts over here and flows across the plate and hits South America and then goes to our X marks the spot. It's like the obstacle standing in the way of its final destination. You know what, guys? Hold on. We just had a new 4.0 earthquake strike over in the Eastern Caribbean and a swarm. A swarm has broken out and a new 4.0 earthquake. Okay. Well, we were looking for up to 5. Instead, we get a swarm with a 4. Okay, whatever. There it is. 3.9, 3.8, 3.6, 3.5, 3.6. All that striking over to the east in the Eastern Caribbean just in the past few hours. All right, let's get into Central America, South America, and the United States portion of the forecast and be done with this thing. Look at Central America. Now, remember what I told you about the volcanic eruptions. We've got a boatload of volcanic eruptions starting to happen over here in the West Pacific. And over here, it's kind of gone quiet. Down to the south, not so much, though. We've got the two new popping up here in Ecuador. But up to the north, we're going to look for new volcanic increase. It usually balances itself out. I don't forecast eruptions. I'm just saying, We got to watch for this to happen over in Central America and South America. In the next few days, I should be reporting to you, guys, look at the big increase across Central America and South America. Okay? As I do that, we're going to watch for new 5.0 earthquakes to strike next to each volcano that I mentioned. Each volcano, West Pacific and East Pacific, to top all this off. So, for instance, Central Mexico, right here, expected new 5.0 earthquake right next to Popocatépetl volcano. Same with down here, Guatemala, expect it, new 5.0 earthquake right next to Fuego volcano. Down here further to the south, at Costa Rica, where Turrialba put off a new thing, a new little volcanic blast this past week, expect it, new 5.0 earthquake striking next to Turrialba. Down here to the south, that gets into South America, where I told you we're looking for a mid-range 5 because of two volcanoes erupting there. So we're in Central America right now. We've got volcanic threat. Additionally, as if we didn't need any more, this big 7.0 earthquake. This earthquake can put lateral pressure across our transfer zones. Look at where our transfer zones are. We've got one here and one here. They're fractures. You see them? It goes back over to the west. Now, oh, people were asking me what this is. That's Leviathan, guys, coming up out of the deep. And so here's our fracture zones, and they trace right back to our large earthquake. So it's going to lose force, don't get me wrong, but we have to watch Central America this week for a similar-sized earthquake, albeit slightly smaller, most likely, than the 7.5. Knock on wood on the slightly smaller part. I hope I got that right. Normally, when one side moves, the other side moves. Okay, so where would we look in Central America? Well, in the past, when we've seen large earthquakes in Papua New Guinea, we've seen large earthquakes up here in Mexico. Also in the past, when we've seen large earthquakes in the far west Pacific over here in Sumatra, we see earthquakes that strike off the west coast of the United States. When we see large earthquakes strike in Japan, we've seen large earthquakes strike down in Ecuador. These usually happen within days of each other. So there is, when we see large earthquakes strike in Vanuatu and in Fiji, we've seen large earthquakes strike off the coast of Mexico. So there's many different points that have a bounce back and forth effect, and professionals tried to play this down just last month when we saw our ping pong ball effect of the 7.0s going back and forth on this side of the plate, and they tried to say they weren't related, then the big 7.9 struck, and they shut their mouths. Oh, and the volcano popped alive over here west of Tokyo, all in the, with a day or two of each other. And they tried to say they weren't related, and then the 7.9 hit, and the professionals shut up about the no, trying to say no relation, because I'm so tired of hearing that. So now let's get into the United States. No 6.8 earthquake struck this past week. No large earthquake struck the last week. The previous week, we had a 5.8, 5.5, 5.0, 4.3. Those struck, that's it. That's all we've seen. So it's been a while since we've had any noteworthy movement. I'm taking it down by a full magnitude, from 6.8 down to 5.8. And the reason I'm reducing it, the rest of the plate is going down right now in number, or at least over past Alaska, once we get past Japan. So we get the pressure coming out from the West Pacific. Once we get over here to the United States, it looks like it's going to be less. Coming out of Alaska, though, a somewhat deep 4.6, not terribly deep, maybe enough to add a little bit more oomph to this. Now, where am I going to watch? This time, we're going to watch a different location than Northern California. We're going to put it all the way up here to the west-northwest next to Haita Gwaii. And I'm probably butchering the name on that. So we're getting really out of the United States, going into Canada to watch for an upper 5 to strike. Once that upper 5 hits, first of all, it's the silent zone. You see this? See how the island stands out in between the sets of quakes? Now, there's been smaller earthquakes that have been striking there in the 3 range and 2 range, but it should be the spot under pressure. Now, what happened off California? I'm still looking. I personally am still looking here for the next couple days, just in case it's taking a little longer than 7 days for this large 7.0 earthquake that I was looking for last week to strike. I'm not going to strike it out yet for myself, but it is definitely an earthquake forecast miss for this past week. You need to watch it too, in case you're an astute student. You guys know there's been many times where I cancel a warning or we get beyond 7 days, and day 8 or day 9, that earthquake hits in some instances. So I'm still watching for a couple days. But as it stands now, new location to the north, threat warning for the 7 has passed because pressure has escaped out. Where did it go? Well, obviously, we've got new swarms popping up all across California, and it's gone all the way over to the Midwest. Gonna have to say, North America has absorbed some of that pressure. Now, does it go away? No. It's like a capacitor. It stores it up for eventual release. So it's not, it's just buying us time. That's all it's doing, really. And that's what I'm gonna tell you now. You were bought some time this week by the plate, absorbing some pressure. That's about it. We're still sandwiched in between the two spots that are moving. We're still looking for an earthquake to strike. It's still the halfway point. Nothing has changed. The only thing that's changed is time. So, and more time equals more energy. More energy equals larger release. So I'm not going to say there's going to be a large earthquake this week here. I'm looking for a 5, upper 5, to be striking up to the west-northwest. Once it hits, then we'll see movement in the United States on land. I would expect a few things to happen. First of all, we're going to see a big swarm break out at Mount St. Helens. So Mount St. Helens should show some movement, and I should say a nice swarm, and also at Mount Rainier possibly as well, a new swarm breaking out. I'll lean more towards Mount St. Helens. And then we go further down to the south, and we get into Northern California, and we're going to look for a swarm up at Mount Lassen again. So the volcano should start getting hit interior on the coast. I would also expect that we would see a similar-sized earthquake striking back down at the California-Nevada border. So how big are these going to be? Most likely going from mid-range 4 down to low-end 4. So it should be 4s instead of 3s across California this week. But it should be at the volcanoes. Famous last words. Should only be at the volcanoes. But that's what I'm going to look for right now. If anything changes on that, I will definitely update you. I'm dialing it back a whole notch from where I was last week for many reasons. One, not a lot of deep earthquakes. Two, centered over in the West Pacific with a 7.0 earthquake. Three, the likelihood of a large earthquake striking now centers on Central America for the most part, famous last words as well, and then down to the east-southeast on the edge of the Craton. There's the only other spot that we have to watch. So east-southeast, edge of the Craton, where does that put us? A new micro swarm, a new little swarm of microquakes is due at Yellowstone. This is getting to be a repeat broken record at this point. If we get an earthquake up to the west-northwest, up in Canada of any significant size, even if it's a swarm of threes, that's enough to push all the way across the edge of the plate. If we get a 5 up there, that's enough to push all the way down to the Midwest. And that's what happened this week. So we got a 5 up here. That pushed us on a 3.0 basis going all the way down through Colorado. I would imagine if there's something larger up here, that's going to push us a little bit more. Each spot that you see now expected a half magnitude larger, basically. So 3.6 should go up to near 3.9 to 4.0. 2.9 should go up to about a 3.9 and so forth. It's kind of a lackadaisical forecast for this week on the United States since we did not get hit. I'm watching. I'm waiting. I want to know what happened to the energy out here. I want to know why there's no earthquakes being reported out here of any magnitude. Don't you? I mean, do you believe no earthquakes are striking out there? At this point, how many weeks have I been on here telling you, and no earthquakes reported out here? Do you believe there are no earthquakes reported in one of the world's most famously active seismic zones where there's active volcanoes that just erupted in 2015? Do you? Or do you think someone somewhere has put the kill order on the earthquake information coming out of the area? Those are your options. Occam's razor it, guys. Either no earthquakes are striking and we're looking at a megaquake building here of epic proportions, or they're not reporting to us earthquakes. That's the more likely scenario. Really. Either that or you believe earthquakes stop at the state line. Do you believe earthquakes stop at the state line? Does Mother Nature care about Oregon's border? Does Mother Nature even know about Oregon's border? Is Mother Nature sentient? That's a whole nother YouTube video. Hey, that's a whole nother YouTube channel. Okay. Do you have an earthquake plan? Let's be serious. Do you have an earthquake plan? I say this every week. I'm going to tell you again right now. Develop an earthquake plan just in case. You may never have to use it. That would be awesome. You never have to use it. You'd be like, oh, I developed that earthquake plan. Never had to use it. Awesome. Who are you going to complain to? I'm not going to listen. I'm here to tell you, you need to have the plan. And if you never have to use it, you're pretty good. So the plan should be, if an earthquake strikes more than a few seconds long, you start to look around to see, first of all, is it going to be going on for more than a few seconds? And if it is, you're going to a place that you've already thought about going, underneath a table or a desk. And you will have already pre-planned this out. So you won't have anything breakable sitting next to the table that could fall over and break right on you or something, right? You will set this table out as a spot that you're going to go to. You don't go to a door frame unless absolutely it's the last thing. Door frames sometimes are decorative. Sometimes they're for closets. Sometimes they're not structural. And the door frame thing is not recommended by professionals at all. It comes from a wives' tale, apparently, okay? So go underneath table or desk if it's going on for more than a few seconds. And if it's a very large earthquake, you'll know within a few seconds. And if you're in a brick, cinder block, any kind of stone structure, I noticed somebody was using the museums as an example. Yeah, I mean, if you're a museum is a stone structure a lot of times, right? And if it's concrete or cinder block, even if it's reinforced concrete, you probably don't want to be in that stone structure in a large earthquake. Again, but if it's over, if it's just a few seconds, I mean, obviously you're not going to be able to get out of there. But if it's going on for 20 seconds, 30 seconds, a minute, you need to get out of those structures. You need to immediately head outside. But you need to know what's outside, because otherwise you're going out into an environment where things could be falling from even further than a normal inside environment. Right? That brick exterior could be falling off the outside, falling 20, 30 feet, and then hitting whoever's down below. So I want you to be ready for it and be prepared. That includes knowing your surroundings. Now finally, let me tell you, you need to have what's called an emergency kit or a bug out bag. The bug out bag is a slang term to describe the bag that you grab when you're leaving out of the structure and you're either going to not be coming back or you're coming back to a destroyed house. And so the bug out bag should have one day's worth of supplies in it. Whether you're talking about food or water, it's probably not going to be that much you need for a day, or more like the survival kit kind of stuff. So a first aid kit, a way to clean yourself, sanitation, multi-tool, flashlight, a way to charge your phone, a way to communicate if you don't have that walkie-talkies of some kind to communicate with people over a short distance. Those kind of things now. Oh, extra ID, extra set of keys. Those kind of things now will make a big difference. That's like 10 things less that you have to fumble around and try to find while you're in an emergency. I would also recommend a change of clothes in the bag as well, just if in case the earthquake's in the middle of the night, maybe even a set of shoes that in case it strikes in the middle of the night, you don't have to go fumble for some clothes to go put on. You can just grab that bag and go outside and put on those jeans or whatever you've got rolled up in the bag. So those are my, you know, just general tips of advice. Final piece of advice is don't be scared. Be prepared. Have an earthquake plan. I say don't be scared, be prepared all the time. I know it sounds kind of cheesy, but you can remember it. It's easy to remember. Don't be scared, be prepared. Because it's like a fireman or a soldier or whatever, that if you're going to be rushing into an emergency type situation or be thrust into one, it's better be prepared for it. It might still be quote-unquote scary, but you can survive that fear and then replace that fear with vigilance. And that's why I do what I do with the earthquakes and the forecasting. We just let you know areas where we see pressure building. As I'm talking here right now, a new 5.6 earthquake has just struck the Solomon Sea. How about that? New 5.6, let's go get our magnitudes on this. This is right in that little warned area we just talked about. Let's open it up. Papua New Guinea. East New Britain. Here's the Solomon Sea. Hold on, let me get this turned on. Here is the Solomon Sea. So the earthquake has just struck now on the edge of the New Britain Trench on New Britain on Solomon Sea. And here's the Solomon Islands, and here's our triangular bend. So our 5.6 struck just to the west of our triangular bend in the Solomon Sea. Okay, wow, all right, well, moving already. Things are already moving. Have a plan, be prepared. Do you like what I do here? If you like what I do, please subscribe. I'm trying to get people to subscribe to my YouTube channel still. I know it sounds childish, but it really does matter in the overall scheme of how people view your channel on YouTube. So I am trying to grow it. Please subscribe if you can. And it'll make a difference just how people perceive my channel. It doesn't really help other than that. Also, it'll help you get my updates, I guess, that it'll come into your little subscription feed or to your email, and you'll get it that way. That'll be awesome. Secondly, if you want to support my operation financially, and this is serious, if you want to support it, there is a link down below to PayPal that goes directly to me. So if you want to send something directly to me, you just use the PayPal link, or Patreon. Patreon is a way that people do it once a month, and it's $1 or $5 or $10, whatever you want to choose. And I do $1 for other video makers, and it adds up with hundreds of other people who do it, and it goes to pay them a salary. So, you know, one person on their own, $1 might not be that much, but with 600 other people, it does, and that's how many people are signed up with me on Patreon. 638 or 40 people. It's really awesome. So all of you are very, very generous, and it adds up every month. I appreciate that, and it gives me a salary. All right, we're done. Class is dismissed. Guys, please be safe. Do not be scared. Be prepared. I will have a forecast out for any updates that happen throughout the week. So if any new deep earthquake strike, you know where our letter D's are. You can see them on the map. Those are the events that I don't really forecast for. Unless we have some good evidence to show that there's going to be a deep earthquake coming. So I watch for the deep earthquakes as the wild cards that get thrown in throughout the week. As these wild cards get thrown in, we may have to adjust the forecast throughout the week. As that happens, right now, you can see the deep earthquakes on the map, and those are dictating where we're watching currently. Okay? That's all we've got. The time now, 11:17 p.m. Central Time on the 25th of February, 2018. It is already almost March. Can you believe that? Wow. We'll be back if anything else goes down. Hey, the people over in Papua New Guinea, perfect example of why you guys need to have an earthquake plan. There's a 7.5 on land. Could you imagine? Could you imagine on the West Coast, United States? Thank God I got it wrong. Thank God. I don't know. I mean, some people were rooting for it. I'm not. I was not rooting for it this week. I'm like, God, man, I don't want to be right. So I'm willing to beat my head. Again, I've told you 1,000 times. I'll tell you 1,001. I'd rather be wrong and tell you about an area that I think is going to get hit, than to hold my tongue and hope that, you know, oh my God, you know, oh, people are going to hate me if I tell them and it doesn't hit. What do I do when it hits? If I hold my tongue and then the earthquake hits, you know how guilty I'm going to feel? I'll feel like the weight of 1,000 deaths is on my shoulders. I wouldn't be able to sleep at night. I'd get haunted by people who was like, why were you so fearful to issue the warning? I'm dead now because of it. Thanks, Dutch. Could you imagine the ghosts coming from that? Now, I'm being jovial on that, but I'm serious that I'd rather be wrong and issue a warning than not issue the warning for the hope that I'm going to save face. This is YouTube. My face is already... it got smeared before I ever even got on here, but you get on here and you immediately they hit the smear button. So, you know, whether I get it right or whether I get it wrong, I get beat up online. And we know that from past experience. So you guys, word up, much love, thanks for sticking with me, and we'll see you back here tomorrow night. And if anything else happens in between, peace out.